Father, we thank you for the greatest gift that mankind has ever known when Jesus came. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. And in order to do so, he had to come to the stable. He had to come at the right place at the right time. And he had to grow up, and he had to walk one day up Golgotha's hill and die on the old rugged cross. Lord, that we could be forgiven, that we could have mercy, that we would know grace. And Father, on this special occasion, we lift up to you those who are hurting, those who are lonely, those who think they can't face another year, can't face another day, don't know how they're going to carry the burdens that they have. Maybe the cupboard is empty. Maybe the job is dried up. Maybe their health is in decline. Dear Lord, put your arm around about them. Use the spirit that's in this place today to reach out into the neighborhoods and let them know that somebody's thinking about them and somebody's praying for them. Lord, you care about each one of us, and you love us unconditionally. Thank you for this opportunity to be here on Christmas Day. Bless the pastor as he preaches this morning. Use him for your glory and honor. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Jerry. I failed to mention the young man that was killed behind the Rural King, was killed right outside Reuben and Carolyn, Kim and Wendell's business down there. And Kim was telling me that the mother had four children. Now three of them she's lost, two to car accidents, and this young man was shot dead by someone who had shot someone else in October. He should have been in jail.
Amen.
Pray for that mother. Pray for that other son. He's 16 years old. They need our prayers this morning. If you would, please, what a great service. Thank you all so much. Thank you all for coming and playing. Beautiful. Wayne, thank you so much. We should have called, you should have named Joseph David. Way he plays that harp. Instead of Joseph. But, you know, the secret is out on Joseph, by the way. Joseph has a voice that you will not believe. And one of these days, I'm going to coerce him into singing for us and let us all hear it, because it is absolutely dynamite. And I'm coming after you, Joseph. I'm going to talk to you into singing for us.
That's a good line.
I was astonished. It was kind of like hearing Gomer Pyle for the first time. He could sing. He can sing. If you would this morning, I promised you that if God didn't change my mind, I was going to preach on the Christmas tree. And you can turn your Bibles into Romans chapter 5. We'll get there in a minute. But I cannot absolutely say for certain where and when the Christmas tree became a part of the Christmas celebration. I can tell you this, that the first mention of the Christmas tree was made by a man in Strasbourg, Germany in 1604. A. Tilly wrote in his book, Yule and Christmas, at Christmas they set up fir trees in the parlors in Strasbourg and hang their own roses cut out of many colored paper. That was the first mention of the Christmas tree. The whole idea doubtlessly came from Protestantism. Okay? Now, I found another quote that I found rather interesting. Also from a young man from Germany. His name was Dr. Johann Danhauer. And he said this, "Whence comes the custom, I know not. It is child's play. For better were it to point all the children to the spiritual cedar tree, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
But put simply, there is no scriptural evidence, there's no scriptural points or teachings or references in the Bible of a Christmas tree.
Amen.
Now, with that being said, don't get me wrong. I love a beautiful Christmas tree.
Mm-hmm.
But I've taught my son and I teach my grandchildren that not to worship that tree.
Amen.
It's wonderful and beautiful to have a tree, but that is not what Christmas is.
Thank you.
We've used it as a materialistic prop to celebrate Christmas. And it's okay to have one. Just make sure your children understand that you're not worshiping that Christmas tree.
Mm-hmm.
It's just there to add glory. It's just there to add beauty to the reason for Christmas.
That's good.
But with that being said, I do want to declare to you that God has his own Christmas tree.
Yes.
It's actually called the Cross of Christ.
Amen.
Yes.
In fact, the proper name for the cross is a tree. If you looked in Acts chapter 5 and verse 30, it says this: the God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree.
Yeah.
Then Peter said in 1 Peter 2:24, who his own self bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live with unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. So this morning, I want us to look at some presents that God the Father has given us under God the Son's Christmas tree. These gifts are infinitely beautiful because they come from the heavens. They were not bought at a sale, for Jesus paid the full price with his precious blood.
Yeah.
Just because they're spiritual does not mean that they're not practical.
Yeah.
They are practical and they are relevant for us today in this present hour. We often think of salvation as being something that is future, as if it reads on the package, do not open until eternity. But salvation is much more. We think of salvation in times of and in ways of streaks of gold and walls of jasper and gates of pearl and robes and harps. That's how we think of salvation. But salvation that God gives is a salvation that is right now for mankind. And it brings gifts to you and to me. They are underneath God's Christmas tree, the cross of Christ.
Amen.
You see, we are justified by faith. In fact, that is the only way God justifies anyone, is by faith. And he's doing more than just justifying us. He is forgiving us. When the word justifies means just as if I had never sinned.
Yeah.
So, God justifies sinners. How? He takes those that are guilty and he makes them guiltless. Takes those that are guilty and makes them guilty. Guiltless. And you know what he does? You heard the movie Rebel Without a Cause? That's what Jesus does. He justifies us without a cause.
Amen.
Because he came.
Yeah.
Because he paid the price.
Amen.
He justifies us. So here we go this Christmas morning, And I want us to look under God's Christmas tree, and I just picked out a few of the gifts that God has given us that I want to speak to us about this morning. The first one is found in Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, that's the Christmas message. If you look up the Christmas message in Luke chapter 2 and verse 14, you'll find that it says there, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace and goodwill toward men. Do you know how you get peace? The Bible says that you get peace through, it comes by the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
By his death on the cross, he made peace between a holy God and a lost sinner like me and you. God, the Lord Jesus Christ, I call him God because he is God. He made the peace between God the Father and a guilty lost sinner like me.
That's good.
Peace comes from the knowledge that sins have been forgiven. You don't get any greater peace than that. My sins have been forgiven, and believe me, they are many. But they have been forgiven, cast in the sea of forgetfulness for him never to see again. Peace is at the foot of the cross. All you have to do is pick it up. What a gift. The second gift is found in chapter, verse 2. By whom also we have access by faith unto this grace. That word access there, it's in the Old Testament, they didn't have access to God.
No.
Because the tabernacle shut them out.
Yeah.
They couldn't go into the Holy of Holies, get access to God. Only the high priest once a year could go there. So they didn't have access. One of the glorious things about this day that we live is the fact that we have direct access to the throne of God.
Amen.
Hebrews 4, verses 14, 15, 16 says it most wonderfully. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. Let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. The next gift that we have is the gift of hope, also in verse 2. It says, by whom also we have access by faith unto this grace, wherein we stand, rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Now, when I studied this lesson this week, last week, I found something that I had not seen when I read that verse of scripture before. I look at that and I say, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Like that's something good. But do you know what is glory? The glory of God is a fearful thing. It is something that is going to be revealed on this earth. Watch this. You recall when the people of Israel sinned, the Bible says that the glory of God would walk through the camp, and in judgment, he would deal with those people.
Yeah.
You'll read about it, you can turn to Numbers chapter 16. It's full of it. The glory of God will appear again upon this earth. We call it the second coming. We're told that Christ is coming again, and he will, but not as a babe in Bethlehem. But watch this. He's coming in power and what? Great glory.
Amen.
So when he comes, it's not going to be a happy thing. It's going to be a judgment. He's coming in power and great glory. Now, we need not fret or worry about that because we're not going to be there. We're going to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we'll be coming back with him, but we won't be on the earth to go through the wrath that those people are going to go through. Because we've been trusted and trusting in Jesus Christ, and we've been justified by the Lord Jesus. And according to Titus 2:13, we have the blessed hope.
Amen.
And the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We have hope. What a gift. The hope of the glory of God.
Amen.
And we'll see those that are there that don't have the hope that we have. And it will not be a pretty sight. The next one I want to talk about is found in Romans chapter 5 and verse 5, and it is the gift of love. It said, "And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. Hope needeth not to be ashamed, or maketh not to be ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts." Now, we often think about that, that love of God, and we sing about it. And I love the song, and I really wanted to get Allie to sing a verse or two of it this morning, but she couldn't be here. But those words that says "shed abroad," you know what that means? That's like an oil gushing out of an oil well. Shed abroad. That's what the love of God is.
That's good.
The love referred to is not, has anything to do with emotions.
No.
It has everything to do with the fruit of the Spirit. Love is a fruit of the Spirit, okay? It means that the love of God that he gives to us is like the love that he had when he said, "For God so loved the world,
amen,
that he gave his only begotten Son,
yeah,
that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life."
Amen.
The love of God. The next thing is also in verse 5. It says, "And the hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in the hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us."
Amen.
The next gift is the Holy Ghost. Now listen, you can't buy it. It is automatically given to you the day that you receive Christ as your Savior. The Holy Ghost comes and lives in your heart.
Yes.
God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. You are truly saved. You become a child of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Okay? He instantly places your name on that gift. That gift of the Holy Spirit comes, and the Bible says, indwells you.
That's good.
He seals you. He keeps you until the day of redemption.
Yes.
Jesus said in John 14, verses 16, 17, 18. Let me go there real quick. John chapter 14, verses 16, 17, 18. "And I pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you."
Yes.
Notice how it says there in verse 5, says that the Holy Ghost which is given unto
Amen.
Us.
Amen.
It is a gift of the Lord Jesus Christ.
You brought it out.
Given to us.
Yeah.
Because of his death, burial, and resurrection. The last one that I want to talk about is found in Romans chapter 5 and verse 9. It says, "Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath through him." Delivered from the wrath. Delivered from the wrath to come. A lot of times people ask me to give them a verse of scripture that proves that Christians will not go through the great tribulation. Well, this is just one of many. So what is the wrath that he's talking about? What is the wrath from which we are saved? It's not so much the great tribulation period. We're saved from that. But we're saved from the wrath of the glory of God that he is going to distribute on those people.
Yes, amen. Nothing.
You see, these people, the Lord Jesus' cup of iniquity is being filled up.
Yes.
The stage is being set, and then the judgments are going to come just as they were predicted, just as they were foretold, just as they will happen. But we will not be among those people.
No.
Because we'll be called out in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. It's called the rapture of the church. Now millions of people will turn to the Antichrist. They will follow his one world government. They will follow his one world religion. And they will follow him. And the Bible says that they will believe a lie and be damned.
Yes.
He will not bring peace as he promises to bring. The only thing he's going to bring is the battle of Armageddon. But we will not be there. Verse 9 assures us that we are delivered because we have been saved from the wrath of God.
Amen.
Now look at verse 10. For if we, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. If we're not going to be in the wrath of the glory of God, it's simply because we'll be saved by being reconciled unto him, with him being our Savior.
Amen.
Thank God for the wonderful gifts under the tree of his dear Son. We have peace. We have access. We have hope. We have love. We have the Holy Spirit. And we have deliverance from the wrath to come. This morning, we have a couple that want to join our church. And I'm going to open the church doors this morning. Mike, if you would come and give a song. And I trust that you learned something this morning from the precious word of God, from the gifts that are at our beck and call. All we have to do is claim them.
Amen.
They're there.
Amen.
Let's just claim them.
Amen.
And rejoice in what Christ has done for us. This is Christmas Day, literally. This is Christmas Day. Now they say, we wasn't born on the 25th. This is the day we celebrate.
Yeah, that's right.
Christmas. So this is Christ's birthday today. I just read you all the names, all the gifts, not all, many of the gifts that Christ died to give us. Have you ever asked yourself, what can I give him in return? There's a great song that says it best. If Jesus could sing any song to us this morning, I believe he would sing it. All I want for Christmas is you. If you want to give him a gift, if you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, today is the most wonderful day of the year.
Thank you.
To give your life,
amen,
to the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for you. Mike, come and get a song. We're going to open the doors of the church. If you want to come this morning, we'll more than welcome you into our fellowship.
I once wandered,
amen,
in sin and despair, but the Savior heard and answered my prayer, broke the chains of Satan, setting me free. is he. What a wonderful Savior is he. What a wonderful Savior to me. How he loved me so I never could see. What a wonderful Savior is he. How I praise him, bless his wonderful name. I forever his goodness proclaim. For me, what a wonderful Savior is he. What a wonderful Savior is he. What a wonderful Savior to me. How never could see. What a wonderful Savior is he. Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. He washed it white as snow, and when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my sins to save. My lips shall still repeat.
Jesus did it.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He white as snow.
Thank you, Brother Mike. We have Jeff and Victoria McGill coming to join our church by statement. So I want to ask you, if you would, both of you, just give your testimony when you receive Christ as your Savior. And then we'll discuss that. So you want to go first, Victoria? Okay.
So I was raised up in a Baptist church. My mom does it with you. Friends got Baptist church. And when I was a little kid, you know, there was just something seemed different about me than most people, or most kids. And you know, I went up to the altar and got saved, and my life had changed.
Yeah.
It changed tremendously. You know, I was just different than every other kids my age and stuff. And I was kind of quiet and everything, and God is just, I mean, when you look back on your life, You know, when I was 16, we think we'll live forever. And we'll stay 16, then we end up 50, and then 60. So time just goes by. It's like a vapor today on the morning. But so God has been, had his hand on me all my life so much. But when I was about 9 years old, it was a lot of seeds of love in my heart.
Amen.
You know, I haven't always been perfect. I've always done things hard-headed. And, God gets the glory no matter what. And I know whatever I do that's worth anything that he done, and whatever I did that's not, this is what I got involved in. So I know that nothing that I do is any good, but I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me.
Amen.
And we all can. And if man has done it, has built it, or whatever, you can do the same. You know, so because God gave them the knowledge to do it, and he can help us the same way to do the same.
Yeah, you're right.
And I'm a handyman by trade. I do different things, but I'm kind of retired by now. So, you know, if anybody needs anything or whatever, you know, and I can help in any way, shape, or form, I've got my hand out. So, you know, if I can help anyone in any way, prayer or whatever, you know, God will provide.
Well, when I was a little girl in 1969, the neighbor girl, my best friend at the time, Wendy, came over, and she was in a Christian school, and it was Christmas time, and she had all of these Christmas stories and things she knew in the Bible, and I didn't know anything. And my father was such, he was an aerospace engineer, and he got jealous and mad that the little girl next door knew more about Christ and Bible stories than I did. So he, for 2 years, I went to the Christian school that the neighbor came to. And when I went, Christ was real to me. I could almost see him as a child. I believe 100% everything about Christ, and he was my Savior. And then things happened in my family, and I grew up, and I got out in the world in Los Angeles, and I was out there for 40 years in that wilderness of myself, being hurt and sad and mad at the Lord about things. And then in 2013, Jeff came into my life, and he came to my mother's house to fix the roof. And he was there for 10 days, and I thought it was amazing because he was working all through Super Bowl, and everyone else I knew was watching the Super Bowl, and he was up there. 3 days later, one of the biggest storms came through Los Angeles, and I didn't lose. I had plaster and lap and things like that, and I would have had all kinds of damage, and it hadn't been taken care of. So that was my introduction to Jeff in my life. And then my mother passed away, and he got divorced, and I had more repairs on the house, and it worked out where he came and helped, and we fell in love that way. But then it seemed like as soon as I married him, you know, Satan came for me.